good evening, church. We're going to do something a little different tonight. Normally, what Wednesdays look like is we have a gathering, a larger group that meets in Kirkendall Hall. We expositorily go through the scriptures, verse by verse, and pick up truth and learn the systematic doctrine of God through His Bible. And then I'll go and then head to my office and say, what's one sermon I can preach from this? And then I'll preach and hear. And tonight I felt called to actually bring a condensed version of the study that we do on Wednesday to see how that flows in here. So what we're going to do is go through the scriptures together. We're in the book of Romans, starting Romans chapter 1. It's become one of the strongest foundational books for Christ's church. The words of the scriptures will be on the screen. We provided a handout for you. If you don't have one and would like one, please raise your hand and Brad, our elder, will get it for you. Good one. If you're like me, just listen along and soak it up. Write down questions you have. If you're like someone who's not me, take lots of notes. And use the handout, that's fine. Whatever works for you. The most important thing is that you're able to comprehend and receive and be obedient to the word that the Lord speaks. Romans chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, a servant of Christ, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God. Now right here we have a blank that I've got on your sheet if you want to use it. Paul starts using language right out of the gates where he's not stumbling and falling. He's saying exactly what his qualifications are. Number one, he says, and the word is servant in my scripture, but in the Greek it's really saying Paul a doulos, a slave of Christ Jesus. Somebody who didn't sign up for this, somebody who woke up like this. I have become a slave for Jesus. Next thing he says, I've been called. Another Greek interpretation of that is, I've been summoned, commanded. I didn't make this up. God made me a slave of Jesus. He called me to be an apostle. As we discussed last 2 weeks, apostle means sent one. Somebody who has witnessed the resurrected Christ and went out in their sin. And then it says, I've been set apart for the gospel of Christ. Set apart. Paul uses the word all throughout his writings that's similar to the word set apart. And instead of set apart, he says a saint. That's why we call him St. Paul. I say St. Paul so you know I'm not talking about myself. Pretty much. And it's quicker than saying the Apostle Paul. Just St. Paul. So in case you've been wondering, do I pray to the saints and all that? No, it's quick. Saint, set apart, is the same idea. And that means that Paul's saying in Christ, and this is not just for him, but every Christian rebirthed in the Holy Spirit, that we have been set apart, not as holy people ourselves, but the work that's going to be done through us is holy work. He'll get to that later in Romans, but we have been selected by God as members of His bride for a holy purpose, set aside, set apart for a holy purpose. And so it's important to know, and I mentioned this before on Wednesday nights, that as a Christian, as a saint of the church, set apart for holy use, that you use your life primarily for this holy purpose to witness for Jesus Christ. A strong example that I brought up is especially during an election cycle. Many Christians have been using our sainthood to preach the gospel of Trump or of Sanders or of whoever. I'm not saying I don't have political beliefs. I have political beliefs. I'm politically involved. But what I am saying is the volume of a Christian to preach the gospel of a politician should be turned down. Because the volume to preach Christ should be turned up. That's our job. That's what we're set apart to accomplish. So St. Paul's saying, out of the gates, he is a slave of Jesus Christ, commanded, summoned to be an apostle, and like all of us, set apart for a holy use for the gospel of God. The gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets and the holy scriptures regarding his son, who, as to his human nature, was a descendant of David, and through the Spirit of holiness was declared with power to be the Son of God. By his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord, through him and for his name's sake, we received grace and apostleship to call people from among the Gentiles to the obedience that comes from faith. And you also are among those who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. To all in Rome who are loved by God and called to be saints, famous words you've heard every Sunday, grace and peace to you from God the Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. So Paul describes what he's all about, and he makes sure, we've got a blank, a couple down, that says that everything hinges, and Paul's understanding, everything hinges and is activated through the work in the name of Jesus. He makes that clear all throughout. He's not going to water down the work of Jesus Christ. He's not going to empty the cross of its power. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus is all in Paul's writings. Now, I've got some notes here that begins with Jesus preaching. It's important to understand, and we preached a particular gospel in terms of content. And the scriptures record it. It says, everywhere that Jesus went, he preached the good news. And do you remember what? The good news of the coming kingdom of God. That's what's good news. The good news, and what that means is, well, every parable he taught was a parable to describe the kingdom. Every power he did was a demonstration of the kingdom. All the teachings, all of his work was based upon the kingdom of God. And the reason it's good news is because Jesus' gospel was not, if you believe in me, you don't go to hell. His gospel was not, if we all band together as humans, we can achieve great things. That wasn't his gospel. His gospel was, God is up to something that can't be stopped. And it's coming like a freight train. And it's not from this world. Jesus entered Jerusalem on a donkey as a demonstration of that glory and power. He came to take the city, which he did. The kingdom of God is at hand. The kingdom of God is coming. That's the gospel of Jesus. Now, it's important to know the difference between Jesus' teachings and St. Paul's. Jesus was preaching this gospel of the kingdom. St. Paul's primary teaching, got to get my words right here. His preaching and teaching is about how that kingdom involves the species of humans specifically. When Jesus is talking about the kingdom of God, he's talking about this universal move. I'm not talking about universal salvation. What I mean is universally, God is going to work in the lives of, as I mentioned on Sunday, ants. Trees. There'll be a new creation. I mean, the new heavens and the new earth. He's talking globally. I mean, huge kingdom coming. It's going to affect every atom and ounce. Every part will be treated right and replaced with a resurrected life. St. Paul's concerned with, what does that mean for the human? What's the mechanics? He's looking out for our species of creature. What does it mean for the image bearers of God? So his perspective is all about the kingdom of God is coming through Jesus' work. How and why will we be redeemed with it? Is that clicking? That's Paul's slant. He goes on to write that, first I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you, because your faith is being reported all over the world. God, whom I serve with my whole heart in preaching the gospel of his Son, is my witness how constantly I remember you in my prayers at all times. And I pray that now at last by God's will, the way may be open for me to come to you. I long to see you so that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to make you strong. That is, that you and I may mutually encourage each other by each other's faith. I do not want you to be unaware, brothers, that I planned many times to come to you, but have been prevented from doing so until now, in order that I might have a harvest among you, just as I have had among the other Gentiles. Now, here's a word we need to sit on. Paul writes in verse 14, I am obligated. Obligated. In Greek, the word obligated is the same word that's used for indebted. Where do we hear that word? Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. St. Paul is pointing out that he is indebted to this ministry. I think we all know pastors or leaders or preachers that say, I should be getting more credit for what I'm doing. Or I've even run into pastors that say, I don't tithe through the church because I give so much of myself in ministry. You wouldn't believe what other preachers tell other preachers. version of ministry is, I'm in the red. I don't even deserve to have life. I'm indebted to the Father who's called me to this ministry. So don't send me a cookie in the mail or a trophy. This is what I'm doing. This is my living sacrifice for Jesus, is to reach out for the Gentiles. He didn't know that people in London, Texas, that speak a different language thousands of years later would be reading his work. He was claiming over and over and over that his calling to the Gentiles was because he is indebted forever to God. And out of that indebtedness, he knows he's forgiven of the ramifications. And he's going to live as a slave to who? To Jesus. So he's indebted to these people. And I'd like to point out real quick, just for clarification, I'm obligated both to the Greeks and the non-Greeks, both to the wise and the foolish. What Paul's saying to the Romans here, he's not saying to the Greeks and Jews, which is normally what's implied here. He's saying to the Greeks as a people who live in the Greek way of life, the Roman way of life, versus barbarians, which is a harsh word. But there are some people he ministered to, Galatians, the Gauls, that were different than the Romans. They were treated as, there are rivalries going on between the nations, like there are today in the United States with other countries. Paul's writing to say, I'm not just called to people who look like you, and think like you, and walk like you, or as sophisticated as you. I'm also called to folks that you consider a threat. I'm bringing the gospel to all the Gentiles across the board. That is why I'm so eager to preach the gospel also to you who are in Rome. And this is, if you get anything from this entire book, this is what I want you to get. Verses 16 and 17. The reason this is important, what we're about to read in verse 16 and 17, has been, for some reason, anointed in the Holy Spirit to convert several people, including some big-time power brokers. This is how the church got Martin Luther. He was studying this, preparing to be a priest, and he was overwhelmed by the gospel. St. Augustine, same deal. Calvin was influenced by this. The strongest leaders we've had since the Reformation have been because of these two verses. So check this out. I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes. First for the Jew and then for the Gentile. For in the gospel, a righteousness that comes from God is revealed, a righteousness that's from faith, from the first to the last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith. Now, you've heard this before. It's called the gospel. But Luther hadn't heard it this way. And I'm willing to bet many of us have heard it this way, and we haven't heard it this way. And all of Paul's writing is going to be building a case to the fact that we were up a creek as a species. And this is how God's going to deal with it. Luther was raised in a Catholic church, which is a great church. It's different than our beliefs. There's some great things that come from the Catholic church. And the teaching of what was required to be right before God is different than what the evangelical mind says, the evangelical understanding of Scripture. I've got a note here if you want to write it down this line. Righteousness is what we're talking about. Righteousness means a condition that's acceptable to God. A condition that's acceptable to God. What is God? And the deal is that God cannot be in communion with someone or something unless the conditions are met. It just doesn't work. God's holiness doesn't allow it. And so St. Paul's saying there is a gospel. And through the gospel, this has become God's power to adopt and redeem people that are currently not in God's family. We're going to get to the depths of that in just a minute. He's going to talk about the Gentiles, us. And he says, the gospel, the first thing the gospel does is that when you hear it, it reveals something. It specifically says it reveals the righteousness that comes from who? God. God's righteousness. See, Martin Luther had been living in this mindset that while Jesus died on the cross, and because Jesus is the one that did all the work, he still gets all the credit. But the means in which we receive the benefit and the righteous act of Jesus is through the sacramental actions of the church. That's kind of the idea of, what if I died and I haven't been baptized? Right? We've asked that question. What if I haven't been baptized? This, to say that someone is brought into the righteousness of God through sacraments means that you're baptized at a certain age, you're probably confirmed. But that also means that all of your answers, according to righteousness standards from the Catholic Church, depend on the sacraments, not on the work of God. That was the whole break of the Catholic Church and the Reformation. So, the basic teaching is that Luther lived forever was, it's through submission to the sacraments that you find the strength of the righteousness to come over you so that you can live before God and be okay. And what he read here was different. What he read is that he'd been living in a certain society that forever says you have to make yourself righteous, and then God says, I respect your righteousness. Sorry, it's Wednesday night. I'm going to sign his mind up for you. Forever the Catholic Church had been teaching this is based on the Latin form. In fact, even the words were different. The Catholic Church was using Latin, which means justificare, which means that once someone is created justly, then they're recognized as a just person. But what it says in the Greek is the exact opposite, that God looks upon someone, and even though they are not just, and even though they're not righteous, God, in his mercy, decides on his own to say, receive my righteousness. Absolutely, as a gift from God, he makes us righteous. And the word by is highlighted. I've got a note here. The word by in Greek is actually an important word. It means utterly or entirely. We receive the benefit of the righteousness of God by, or utterly and entirely, on the basis of faith. Wouldn't it be a lot easier if you could do some sort of trick or mumbo jumbo or do a little checklist so you can sleep at night? And to have more control over yourself, to say, I participated in my salvation. It'd make me feel better if I knew I could control the destiny of my children. If I could make it so. But what the scriptures teach is that God's righteousness is imparted on whom he is pleased to give it, and it's unlocked through the gift that the Holy Spirit gives. We're going to get to this in Romans, that the Holy Spirit gives that provides people faith. And you can look into your own hearts and realize that no sermon or no teaching or no lesson convinced you to become a believer. It welled up inside of you at some point. You became an adopted child of God. And it's through that faith experience, that faith recognition, that the righteousness of God, by no act of our own, becomes given to us. And so what was awakening for Luther was, forever he had been living in a system that said, the way you're made right before God is because you become righteous. And what he read here is that the righteousness that makes you righteous is actually an alien righteousness. It's God's. God chooses to put his condition upon you so that even though you're still a sinner, even though you're still a rebel, even though you're still against him in your heart, he says, I don't allow it. And so he goes on to, that's the basic gospel according to St. Paul. God comes and intervenes in the life of people. He gives them the gift of faith. He gives them the gift of righteousness. And it's through that righteousness, the acknowledgement of that righteousness, that you are delivered, you are saved, you are adopted into the family of God. It's as complicated and as simplistic as that. And it's kind of scary because we don't control it, but it's awfully beautiful because we don't control it. The basis of grace. Now he goes on, spends the next rest of this chapter and chapter 2 and the beginning of chapter 3 to point out that both the Gentiles and the Jewish people need alien righteousness because they can't make themselves righteous. He's going to draw that up. So we're going to do the Gentile side real quick. The wrath of God, this is verse 18, the wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all godlessness, wickedness of men who suppress the truth for their wickedness. Now the wrath of God, I've got a note here. Wrath is not some petulant outburst by God, but it's the natural, measured consequence of the fabric and design of his creation. The ancient mind and the mind of the believer today understand and respect this reality. In addition to physical reality, physical reality is a set deal. If there are consequences to the life you live physically, if you go put your hand on a hot stove tonight, I don't care who you think you are or how exceptional you think you are, that will burn your hand. Okay? That's a done deal. There are also spiritual realities. The fabric of creation has been written, and God has been the one revealing how things work. Now, the American mind and the Western mind has flipped it to say, it's called manifest destiny. It's your job to determine what you think and what you want, and then you make it so. But the ancient mind and the believer's mind instead says, it's your job to discern what reality is, and then you align yourself to the truth. We know that with physical reality, don't we? Don't cross the highway on foot. Right? Don't smoke cancer sticks. I mean, there's all sorts of stuff you know not to do, and there's stuff you know to do, and you're good, you're not. I mean, you accept the consequence of physical reality. To come into contact with the outpouring of the wrath of God is part of the consequence of the spiritual reality that has been pre-arranged. And so, God's wrath is not some sort of outburst or he's mad at us. It's a consequence. And we're talking about the Gentiles in this section, and he's not going to be saying anything about Jews, just Gentiles. The Gentiles, here's a blank, are people who know God through general revelation. For instance, he says, since verse 19, since what may be known about God is plain to the world, because God made it plain to them, for since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that men and women are without excuse. So he's appealing to general revelation. And I've got a blank underneath that, as opposed to special revelation, which is what the Jews received. God came to them and spoke to them and gave them the Torah, the Ten Commandments. God revealed his name, Yahweh, to the Gentiles. He's appealing. St. Paul is pointing out, you have enough to have no excuse to be living in rebellion against the fabric of God's world. The basis of sin is that they suppress the truth, which means they not only live against the fabric of reality, the way of God's law, but they try to silence it and commit others to do the same thing. And this is where it comes to the expression. Whenever there's an outpouring of God's wrath, there's some sort of result. On the cross, what we have is Jesus drank it for us, the things that were destined for us. We see the same phrase in Revelation chapter 16. It is finished. It's the same thing we hear on the cross. It is finished, referring to the bowls of wrath. And in this case, as opposed to some end of the world type deal, God's expression of wrath to the Gentiles, and here's a blank, was that God gave them over. says, therefore God gave them over. So I'm going to jump ahead. Jump ahead to verse 24. Therefore God gave them over. There you go. And the sinful desires of their hearts. He's going to say it three times. God gave them over. Another way to say that is God no longer intervened on their behalf. Have you ever wondered how many things didn't happen to you that could have? It's a little weird and scary. Like, we might praise God for our blessings, but we would praise Him a lot louder if we didn't have them that could have happened. What Paul's referring to here is that the intervention that we are benefits of now through Christ and the mercy of the Holy Spirit, which has filled the whole earth, God's intervention and His work in our lives before Christ is what St. Paul's arguing. God at some point stopped intervening. And that's kind of scary. But let's see what happens. There's a progression here. The first thing it says in verse 24 is that God gave them over in their sinful desires. So you're dealing with a bunch of people, just an entire ancestral group of people that had these sinful desires. God allowed it. Next to the blank in sinful desires, in the Greek, it can also be translated an unclean focus. We all have that. Who's here thinking about running home and binge watching a Netflix show? Right? I mean, we are distracted people. We're an idolatrous people. That's the number one sin that's listed in the Old Testament, is that we're idolatrous, a people that cheat on the truth. And it begins with having an extracurricular focus. I want to go home and do this thing, right? Just to be distracted with something other than rejoicing and living in the church. It begins with this unclean focus. So therefore, God gave them over to their sinful desires, unclean focus of their hearts, to sexual purity, for the degrading of their bodies with one another. They exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshiped the created things rather than the Creator who is forever praised. Amen. So number one, God allowed the natural consequence of being focused on something that was unclean to start becoming addicted to watching The Walking Dead every night of the week. Okay? This focus has entered your life, you can't stop doing it. So God, and this is bigger than obviously Netflix, but God allowed that to take place. The next part, so it goes verse 24, 26, 28, the first sinful desires, the next thing it says, God gave them over to shameful lusts. The word lust, I don't think, is the best version. Shameful means something that dishonors you. Instead of lust, I put emotions. And I don't mean the little ones. Have you ever been overwhelmed with emotion? Jesus says, from the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. We're controlled many times by our emotions. If you believe in this, I do. The enemy of the church, the evil one, loves to implant emotions in us that have no root in truth. And we can't. If you were to pause and say, wait, and you audit yourself, why do I feel like that? Is there any reason I feel like that? No. Emotions play tricks. Emotions. And so the flood first is you've got this unclean focus in your life. You've given it room to breathe. Then the next thing that God gave us over to was dishonoring emotions. Now it's welling up in us. We're owned by it. It's consuming us. And here's verse 28. So you go from focus to an emotion. It says, furthermore, since they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, He gave them over to a depraved mind. Does mind have an S after it? Now they're united. Talking about an entire people, the depraved mind. What a depraved mind means, this is, I thought this was powerful when I saw it, means a counterfeit logic. Or reasoning. And what's creepy is what happens next. So you've gone from, you got a bunch of people that aren't focused on the truth. They're focused on other things. Then they become emotionally affected by the things you're focused on. Then they join together having a counterfeit logic, as in not true, false logic. And this leads to something wild. He gave them over to the pride mind to do what ought not to be done. And he goes through this long list. And what I'd like to point out about this progression is that it leads to normalizing an entire people to living and acting and behaving and justifying a complete existence that's a lie. Sound familiar? Paul's describing the rebellion of the human race. People use this text and just talk about homosexuality, or they use a divisive issue or something. They're missing the point. It's huge, and it hits all of us. Don't turn the limelight on one group and say, it's all of us. He's describing the Gentiles. This is the progression, okay? All the way down. Now, what's the result? Verse 29 says, they have become filled with every kind of wickedness, greed, evil. Filled here is the same word that's used to describe what it means to be filled with the Holy Spirit. On Pentecost, the house was filled with the Spirit. The people were filled with the Spirit. And the apostles were filled with the Spirit. But at this moment, St. Paul is describing that humanity was filled not with the Spirit, but with this false, counterfeit way of life. And I'm not going to go through what every one of these words mean. They mean what they say. Although they know God's righteous decree that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these very things, but also approve and applaud those who practice them. I'd like to point out a couple of things. St. Paul's pointing out to the Gentiles, to the majority of us, the people who rely on general revelation, just looking at a sunset and being grateful. Just living within the truth and being a decent person. That's what he's pointing out to. Without the knowledge of the full revelation of that the Jews had. What Paul's arguing is that we and our fall was not based on ignorance. He's taken that off the table. But I didn't know. We are descendants of people who knew. This is a problem of self-will and rebellion. Now, a couple notes before we finish up this chapter. This struck me as interesting. I read a lot of C.S. Lewis, and C.S. Lewis' definition of hell is the ultimate monument to human free will. To be free from God. And the way he describes it in line with this trajectory is not that God would send somebody to hell, but one of two things happens. A humble believer says to the Father, "Thy will be done." Or the Father, through tears, says, "Thy will be done." We've seen what our will leads to. But I'm not going to leave you on a downer. Because Romans 1, 16 and 17 says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. Because it is the power of God to create salvation by faith alone, because it's going to be His unearthly, out of this world, alien to us, righteousness that comes to us. St. Paul is trying to create the case that you are so indebted to the Father. You are so against the truth by your nature as descendants of rebels and a rebel yourself that you couldn't possibly humanize your way out of this deal and negotiate with God. It's got to be God. It's got to be mercy. It's got to be Him creating the right conditions upon you through His Son Jesus. Now, He's got some things to say for the Jewish people too. But you know the answer before we move on. Never forget the gospel. No matter how deep we go, that should increase the mercies. No matter how deep the well's dug, you should know that it fills to the top. That it's God's grace through Jesus Christ that we have become righteous. Let's pray. Father, I ask a blessing as we've tried this tonight and worked through an entire chapter of Romans, which is a dense book. I pray you give us a heart of understanding. I pray, Lord, if there's anyone here tonight that has heard these words of the righteousness of God that comes and is impacted by faith alone, and if this is the first time they've heard it, Lord, I pray that they would rejoice as I have and so many others have had. I pray, Lord, that we would melt any form of self-justification, any form of church justification, and make it all about Jesus Christ. We're humble before you, Father. We love you when we pray this prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen.